serotonin syndrome, you got to remember SSRIs, SNRI. Okay, one is that we discussed just like meperidine. Linezolid. Yeah, what else? Ondansetron. Ondansetron, tramadol. Tramadol.
Tyramine, no?
MAO inhibitors.
Antipsychotic.
Tyramine is the drug that causes the mechanism of tyramine. It causes this mechanism by displacing the nerve. That has got the mechanism of displacement. So it displaces the nerve terminals, for example. Let's say this is the nerve terminal, okay? And tyramine is actually inhibitor. Okay, it displaces the norepinephrine, for example. Let's say here there are some molecules of norepinephrine. Let's say 50% of norepinephrine, 50 molecules of tyramine come here, or 100 molecules here, let's say 200 molecules of norepinephrine are there. So 100 molecules of tyramine will come and they will displace this 100 molecules of norepinephrine. By this particular mechanism, this is a displacement mechanism, and this is predominantly at norepinephrine. Okay, so that is the reason it is not associated. Remember, tyramine is actually the one which is having interaction as a cheese reaction. Remember? Cheese and wine. Okay, so people taking cheese and wine, they should be careful when they are on MAO inhibitors. Remember, monoamine oxidase inhibitor drugs, selective or non-selective? Selective or non-selective?
Non-selective.
Selective one is selegiline, that is MAO B. These are non-selective. Which are the drugs like non-selective MAO inhibitors? Are
isoscarboxyl, phenazine,
trans-cyclopropyl. Phenazine and trinacypro. Reason is because you already know it is pretty understandable. If it is in your GIT, this is non-selective. Monoamine oxidase enzyme, which is present in your GIT, which is responsible for metabolism of tyramine. If you give a MAO inhibitor, the tyramine will not be metabolized and it will go into the blood circulation and it will increase the sympathetic activity by releasing the norepinephrine from the presynaptic transit. Okay? So the next thing is that these are the drugs which cause the serotonin syndrome. Make sure that you are familiar with all these drugs because there are plenty of questions associated with serotonin syndrome. What is the treatment of choice?
Cyproheptadine.
Mechanism of action of cyproheptadine.
HT2A antagonist.
5-HT2.
Antagonist.
Antagonist. Blocker. Okay. Cyproheptadine is the one. What are the other drugs in that? Let's say start from 5-HT1. A. This is buspirone. Buspirone is the drug that is used for generalized anxiety disorder. Drug of choice for GAD, generalized anxiety disorder, buspirone. Right? 5-HT1B, 1D. These are
tryptophan.
All tryptophan groups of drugs. Somatriptan, lisatriptan, naratriptan, all tryptophan groups of drugs. 5-HT2 blockers, 1 and 4 are agonists, guys. 1 and 4 are agonists. 2 and 3 are antagonists. So 2 is antagonist again. So 5-HT2 blocker, what is this?
Can you explain that more?
Yeah, I will tell. Cyproheptadine. Generalized anxiety disorder, the drug of choice is buspirone where the patient is having anxiety, which is it blocks the 5-HT1A receptors. 1B, 1D receptor, your reticulostriatic artery in your brain is dilating, that is compressing your cortex, and that can lead to migraine-like complications. When you give this 5-HT1B, 1D receptor agonist in the brain, it causes constriction of the blood vessels, and in a way, you will have decrease in the symptoms of migraine. Okay? And it's a 5-HT2 blockers. This is actually the blocker. Blocker, imagine like serotonin blocker, because serotonin syndrome was a complication. So serotonin blockers, that is cyproheptadine. What are the other drugs in the same class? What are the other drugs? Ketanserin and ritanserin.
Did they ask this in the exam?
They could ask. The only thing that you got to remember is that ketanserin and ritanserin are the drugs which can be used for hypertension. Okay, and another drug that is there in the class of 5-HT2 blockers is, what is the drug that is used in 5-HT2 blockers? Another drug, please. These are your atypical antipsychotics. What are the atypical antipsychotics?
Clozapine,
olanzapine, quetiapine, risperidone, aripiprazole, right? Clozapine side effect, please.
I don't know.
Adenosine also.
Weight gain.
Okay. Olanzapine, O for obesity. Again, weight gain. Q for
QT prolongation.
Risperidone has also the side effect of QT prolongation. Very important, right? Risperidone, right?
And
including risperidone in that mnemonic that you got to remember, right? Some ischemics can prolong QT, right? And that was a mnemonic, of course, it is very common mnemonic used worldwide. Many students are preparing for USM, remember this, right? S stands for sotalol, right? This was the one. Risperidone was the second. some risky meds can prolong QT, right? That was the one which is commonly used, right? That's for sotalol, which is class?
3.
Class 3 antiarrhythmic. That has the property of class 2 as well as class 3. Because it's a blocker. R for risperidone. And R also for ranolazine. Okay. M stands for?
Macrolides.
Erythromycin. Yeah. C stands for chloroquine. P stands for protease inhibitors. Remember, protease inhibitors all are your previous sulfinavir, indonavir, ritonavir. One thing important you should remember that protease inhibitors are the one which are also enzyme inhibitors. Enzyme inhibitors. Protease inhibitors are enzyme inhibitors. Okay. Remember, acute alcohol. A for acute alcohol. And AVIRS, sulfinavir. One thing you should also remember that all AVIRS have a side effect of hyperglycemia.
Except
atazanavir. So if I say the condition, the patient is having diabetes mellitus. The patient is having diabetes mellitus plus HIV. The protease inhibitor that should be used is atazanavir.
Okay.
Atazanavir. Q. Quinidine. Now quinidine is class 1A drug, right? Class 1A as well as class 3 drug, right? And also Q stands for quinolones. Quinidine and quinolones. T stands for TCA thiazides. TCA and thiazides. These are the drugs which are responsible for prolongation of QT. Remember QT prolongation, whenever there is a condition, you should always give magnesium sulfate for the treatment. Remember, magnesium sulfate also used for the condition of eclampsia. Magnesium sulfate is also used in the condition of toxic rhythm, that is prolongation of QT. Alright? Now these are the drugs and risperidone, and this was aripiprazole. Aripiprazole is termed as dopamine serotonin stabilizer. Okay? So just make sure that you remember SSRIs, fluoxetine, fluoxamine, sertraline, citalopram, escitalopram, all those drugs. Remember, recall their side effects, correlate interactions, all. You should remember. SNRIs, Duloxetine is something important.
Diabetic neuropathy.
M for meperidine that we discussed, which is also known as pethidine, which is having the property of anticholinergic. Okay? And linezolid. What is this linezolid?
It is antibiotic.
Okay, alright.
Okay, it's used for sulfa allergy patients.
Okay, linezolid, we shall be talking about this. I will be just finishing and we will come back to linezolid. As of now, remember, last one point I will say that tramadol has a mu site of action, okay, and tramadol has an opioid-like action, okay, but it is also associated with euphoria because all those opioid-associated drugs have the side effect of euphoria, okay. So tramadol and ondansetron, here comes when I say 5-HT2, 5-HT3 is ondansetron. So ondansetron, granisetron, pralinosetron, all those cetron groups of drugs, they have the side effect of also serotonin syndrome. Remember, cetron groups of drugs, they are used for vomiting, especially antibiotic, anti-cancer drugs are used for vomiting, especially. And if I say anti-emetic drugs, they are anti-emetic, they are agonists and antagonists. Can you recall CB1 receptor? Cannabinoid receptor because the CB1 receptor agonist. So the one only which was agonist that you got to remember, and this was dronabinol. Dronabinol was a CB1 receptor agonist, which was used as an anti-emetic. If I say agonist, that means it should be inhibiting the receptors. That means I can say it is GI coupled. Alright? GI coupled receptors, remember that is MAD2, remember?
MAD2.
Right? M2, alpha-2, and D2. Okay? Recall, M2 was present on heart. Remember, that is the reason it is inhibitory at heart. 5-HT3 was cetron groups of drugs. And the last is 5-HT4. This is easy and this is not that important still in your examination. These are your prokinetic agents. Etopride and cisopride, prokinetic agents. So anyways, what I was discussing basically is that your linezolid. Okay? So when I say linezolid, can you recall linezolid site of action, please? Linezolid, please. What?
50 SFB.
TSFB. Okay. So it is initiation or elongation? When I say this is P site.
Initiation.
This is P site. This is elongation. That is P site is the initiation site. Okay. P site is the elongation site. And here is actually the transcription for sending each and every single amino acid. And this is the enzyme that is actually working, that is what is your peptide transferase. Okay? Okay, and then it is your transportation. So P was for your two drugs, that is aminoglycosides and then activated site, that is the initiation site. Okay, I remember that is the initiation site was the one. I want to explain and I want to go through the pathology as well. I want to mention that this is the site which is your formine. Which is your AUG site, which is recognized by the bacteria. Recall that this is the one which is your bacterial products released. These are responsible for chemotaxis. The chemoattractive molecules, can you recall? Chemoattractive molecules.
Interleukin 8, CD5.
Okay. So whenever there is a damage, for example, these are your phospholipids. Phospholipids are converted by the enzyme phospholipase A. Okay, can tell me the microorganism releasing phospholipase, Clostridium perfringens, which is responsible for crepitus and gas ganglia, which are responsible for the release of phospholipase. This leads to formation of arachidonic acid. Arachidonic acid can go into two pathways. One is either your COX pathway or it can go either to your LOX pathway. If this goes to the COX pathway, then basically it is released, it's responsible for synthesizing of prostaglandin. The most common is PGG2 and PGH2, the first one. Then G2 and H2 leads to the formation of PGI2. PGI2, PGD2, E2 and F2. Individually, we shall be talking about this each prostaglandin later on. Last was thromboxane A2. LOX pathway was going, let's say the most commonly they also use 5-LOX. LOX pathway was responsible for synthesis of leukotriene A4. And this leukotriene A4 was giving rise to leukotriene B4. And then leading to leukotriene C4, D4 and E4. So the point here is that this C4, D4 and E4, they are what are known as SRSA, slow reacting substance of anaphylaxis. And they are the ones which are causing bronchoconstriction. That is one of the main reasons for asthmatic patients. We block these receptors by Monty and Zephyrlucas. Okay? Now leukotriene B4 that you see, it is pretty very nicely designed to the cord. Whenever there is a damage, my phospholipids are damaged, the cell membrane is damaged. Of course, there's a microbe entering. You gotta remember all the steps: margination, rolling, adhesion. Remember? Okay, margination, rolling, adhesion, transmigration, chemotaxis, opsonization, and phagocytosis. All the steps. Remember, recall that steps. In that steps, what I want to mention here is that there is a damage occurring. So of course, we need some chemotaxis, and the chemoattractant here, whenever there's a damage occurring, that is your leukotriene D4. So leukotriene B4 will combine with also another your chemotactic molecule is interleukin 8, C5A, and that is your formal methylene, that is your bacterial products. Okay. These are the four predominantly which are commonly considered as your chemoattractants. Okay. But opsonates, those are your C3B and IgG and C3B. So PGI2, I stand for inhibition. When it inhibits the platelet aggregation, that means it is responsible for vasodilation. PGI2 is also present in your blood vessels. Let's say this is my blood vessel. Okay, in the blood vessel, this is the endothelium. Endothelium of the blood vessel under normal circumstances. Under normal circumstances, you always have PAND. What is this PAND stands for? P stands for PGI2. This is always present because there is unnecessary vasoconstriction should not occur and platelet aggregation should not occur. That is the reason PGI2 is present. A stands for antithrombin 3. This antithrombin 3 is one through which heparin acts, and this antithrombin 3 is against the thrombus formation, so that there shouldn't be any unnecessary thrombus formation. Remember, the primary hemostasis is the first hemostasis that is occurring through your platelet aggregation to, remember that step, that one Willebrand factor and GP1B. Here your platelets will act. Platelet will flip out GP2B3A. Here again, GP2B3A will be flipped out. Another one Willebrand factor through GP1B. Again, the platelets will be there. They flip out this GP2B3A, and they will be attaching in a form for this two GP2B3A. They are responsible for also aggregation of the platelets and fibroblast formation. So that can lead to stabilization of the primary hemostasis. There is a clot formation. So these are the steps which are occurring. So there shouldn't be unnecessary thrombus formation. That's why antithrombin 3 is present. N stands for nitric oxide. This nitric oxide is the one which is acting through cyclic GMP. Remember, cyclic GMP mediated acetylcholine, serotonin, nitric oxide. And nitric oxide, the precursor is arginine. Arginine is the precursor of nitric oxide. T stands for thrombomodulin. Thrombomodulin modulates the thrombin. Thrombomodulin modulates the thrombin. When it modulates the thrombin, what I mean to say is that it will not allow the thrombin to do its own function. That is thrombomodulin. So this will modulate, that means it is also present inside the endothelium. D last stands for TPA. TPA is a tissue plasminogen activator. The drugs which are normally used as a breaking the clot, that we already know, STAR drugs are the streptokinase, tenecteplase, antiplase, and reticulase. All these drugs are tissue plasminogen activator. What they do basically, they activate the plasminogen and convert the plasminogen to plasmin. When this plasmin is formed, plasmin is responsible for breaking the clot by stabilizing or solubilizing the fibrin. Remember, fibrin insoluble is converted to solubilized fibrin. Point here I want to make here is that this is the process by which your factor 12 works. Remember, factor 12 is the only factor when there is a deficiency. It can lead to anybody? Clot formation.
What?
Factor 12. Factor 12 is the only factor. Why? Because factor 12, whenever there is a damage or injury occurring through your intrinsic
pathway.
Through the pre-calicarine and calicarine pathway. This is the one which is responsible for inhibition of excess clot formation. So when this is absent, that can lead to unnecessary clot formation. So factor 12 is the only factor deficiency that can lead to unnecessary clot formation. D2, E2 and E2 are the ones which are responsible for pain, paresthesia and permeability. And the pain, when I say pain, that means prostaglandins are responsible for pain. And the one pyrexia, that is increase in fever. Fever, that is which is predominantly due to prostaglandin E2. Okay, and PGF2 is also, that is a PGF2 alpha, if I say. This is the only prostaglandin which is responsible for vasoconstriction. So I can say all prostaglandin cause vasodilation except PGF2 alpha, which causes vasoconstriction. A for aggregation of platelets, thromboxane A2. This is the one your aspirin works here, that inhibits the thromboxane A2. Okay, so until here, whatever we discussed, we were basically talking about that is your bacterial products and all your chemotactic molecules, how they are synthesized. Next is your last, that is all the remaining drugs how they act. The remaining drugs that they act here, these are aminoglycosides and denisolate. That is the P side. What about elongation side, K side?
Tetracyclines.
Streptogramins. Yeah. Streptogramins are quinu and alpha-prostin, which are the one which are used in a condition of MRSA. Remember, methicillin resistant staph aureus. In this condition, first of all, MRSA is the condition wherein you will use vancomycin. Vancomycin resistant staph aureus, you will use quinu and alpha-prostin. But last ditch effort that you will use is your linezolid. Remember, linezolid is the one which are, because it's an expensive drug, it should be used at the last ditch effort. The earlier you will try with streptogramins, which are quinu and alpha-prostin. The next is your transportation, that is your macrolides and lincosamides. What are these lincosamides? These are your clindamycin. Now, peptidyl transferase is inhibited by chloramphenicol. Now, next thing is that we already discussed, it is very common pneumonia, that is AT13, by AT13, but cells, 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 AT13. That means at 30S ribosomal subunit, your aminoglycosides and tetracyclines will act. Whereas C stands for
chloramphenicol.
E stands for erythromycin, but erythromycin I can say as macrolides. L stands for linezolid. And L stands for lincosamides. Remaining all I mean, that is clindamycin, lincosamides. And S stands for streptogramins, that is quinu and alpha-prostin. So these are the one cannabinoid receptors, CB1 receptors. Can anybody tell me that is NK1 neurokinin receptor, the drug acting? Neurokinin. That is the drug which is your amprapitant. This is the neurokinin, that is for your release of substance P. And this is antagonist. All are antagonists except CB1 is agonist. The last discussion I would like to make is your dorsal column problem. Dorsal column is actually the one. Remember that
tapes dorsalis.
That is okay. Tapes dorsalis, dorsal column problem. Okay, one is tapes dorsalis. Another. SACD.
Subacute
command. Myelination of the spinal cord, which could B12. Be associated with B12 deficiency and
A anterior spinal artery.
Vitamin E. Anterior spinal artery occlusion. anterior spinal artery occlusion is opposite to these two, in which there is pairing of the dorsal
yeah,
bone.
Yeah, yeah,
okay,
sorry.
That is different. Vitamin E. Vitamin E is the one that can also, because it is responsible for inhibiting the free radical injury. Remember, the free radical injury is important side effect or complication that is seen in the patients. Normally, the atherosclerosis risk can be decreased by, it is stated that the theory says that vitamin E and vitamin C are the one which will decrease the free radical damage. Okay, how what happens here is that one is your scavenger receptors which are present on your macrophages. These scavenger receptors never downregulate. You might have remembered the one thing. Can anybody recall from your intestine? From your intestine, what is absorbed first? Chylomicrons. Remember, chylomicrons were absorbed. These chylomicrons are the basically TAD, cholesterol and all. Cholesterol and triglycerides are TAD. They are TAD, remember, it is in the form of cholesterol, ester, and triglycerides. So, cholesterol, ester, and triglycerides are TAD. And what is the marker for chylomicrons? Apo?
B100.
B48. 100 is the one which is for VLDL, IDL, and LDL. So, from here, chylomicrons, they will be absorbed. They will be going. Where they will go first? They will go to the adipose tissue. Then they will go to the adipose tissue. Before going, they need HDL to donate something. HDL will donate ApoC and ApoE. ApoC main function is that it is responsible for stimulation and absorption of the triglycerides through lipoprotein lipase enzyme. So this is your adipose tissue. Lipoprotein lipase enzyme. This is responsible for absorption of triglycerides and cholesterol esters. Then again, there is a chylomicron remnant. This chylomicron remnant which is released, again it will have ApoB48. It will have ApoB48 as the marker. But what happens here is that this ApoE which was donated, ApoC and E which was donated, C is lost now. C is again taken back by HDL. But ApoE persists. Why ApoE persists on the surface of chylomicron? Because ApoE is actually going to be recognized by the liver by your remnant receptor. Remnant receptor are actually the receptor which are going to take the chylomicron remnants. Not only chylomicron remnants, other remnants are also there. So through this ApoE, remember there is a deficient effect of ApoE. ApoE is 3. 3 is type 3 lipoproteinemia. Type 3 lipoproteinemia is actually whenever there is a defect in remnant receptors, so the chylomicrons will not be taken up. So remnant receptor problem type 3, that is ApoE, and the patient will have Palmar's xanthomas. Okay, so that is the remnant receptor. So let's say for example, this is the normal condition. Now this chylomicron remnants are taken up. After that, this chylomicron remnant should come out of the liver. The liver will start synthesizing, not chylomicron remnants released. It is going to synthesize VLDL. This VLDL which will come out, VLDL, four letters, that is ApoB100. ApoB100 will be present here, but remember, it is not cholesterol esters. Now, cholesterol is present and triglyceride is present. So, cholesterol, triglyceride, ApoB100. Now, here HDL again comes. HDL is circulating in the blood. This HDL is responsible for donating again ApoC and ApoE. Again, it will come by donating of ApoC and ApoE. It should come to the adipose tissue for deposition of cholesterol and triglycerides. So, ApoC is again through your lipoprotein lipase again taken up. Cholesterol and triglycerides, and ApoE will be remaining on this VLDL remnant. So VLDL remnant is actually, after when it comes out, it will become IDL. It will become IDL. This IDL, which is formed here, it is having again the marker as ApoB100. But I told you right, whenever the function of ApoC is finished, when the function of ApoC is finished, that means ApoC again goes back to HDL, but ApoE should remain. ApoE should remain, because again remnant receptor is going to work for ApoE. For ApoE, again remnant receptor is going to work, and it is again going to take up IDL remnant. So IDL has two different ways to go. One place the IDL will go is to the liver, back, and IDL could go by LGAT conversion, that is esterification step. This esterification step is by HDL. So HDL is mediating through this enzyme lecithin cholesterol acyl transferase, then leads to the formation of IDL, will again convert to LDL. This LDL, remember, there is nothing like a bad cholesterol. LDL is actually not bad until it is oxidized. So whenever there is an excess of LDL present in the body, if it gets oxidized, this oxidized LDL is actually the complication that is leading to atherosclerosis. What happens to your macrophages, I told you, they have scavenger receptors. Scavenger receptors of macrophages, they are responsible for uptaking of this LDL cholesterol. When they take, they never downregulate. They never downregulate, that means there is a level, until then they are eaten up. After that, what happens? They will burst and they will release all this LDL which was uptaken into the vicinity of the circulation. Starts depositing into the wall of the blood vessel. And the first thing of atherosclerosis that can be seen is your fatty streak formation. Then later on, the particular later complications that are taking place of atherosclerosis can be seen. So what I want to mention here is that LDL is responsible for uptake, that is in the macrophages. LDL is also taken up inside the cells. And now the point I want to mention here is that we have LDL receptors. We have LDL receptors. Now these LDL receptors are responsible for taking up this LDL inside the cell. And remember, the HMG-CoA reductase enzyme was working. That is acetyl-CoA to HMG-CoA. Now HMG-CoA is reduced. Reduction.
Mevalonate.
Now the point here is that after that multitude of steps, there is a synthesis of cholesterol finally. So cholesterol synthesis normally occurs inside the cell. Normally cholesterol synthesis exclusively occurs inside the cell when there is a decrease in LDL circulating in the blood. So if there is a less LDL circulating, cell starts synthesizing the cholesterol. Remember, cholesterol is necessary for the viability of the cell membrane. So when there is a decrease in cholesterol, in such situations, cell itself synthesizes its own cholesterol. The point here is that why we give HMG-CoA reductase inhibitor like statins. Statins are the one which are inhibiting. What are they? Statin inhibit. They are competitive or non-competitive inhibitors?
Competitive.
Competitive inhibitors.